Welcome to the world of high dynamic range and tone mapping. These two techniques are often used together in order to solve a very common problem in lighting, where the combination of multiple lights ends up overflowing the valid range of color, which can be displayed on screen. Remember that we only have 256 discrete values for each of the three channels, red, green, and blue. When we write out the color in the fragment shader, the valid range is 0 to 1 in floating point. This range is mapped by the system to those 256 values. If the output goes above 1, it is simply clamped to 1, that is, 255. In many cases, the end result is an image which is too bright or washed out in some places. The game Riven, which was the sequel to Myst, came out in 1997 and was one of the first games to experiment with HDR. Half-Life 2, Lost Coast from 2005, showcased HDR rendering in the Source engine by Valve and brought dynamic lighting to mainstream gaming. Version 3 of the Unreal Engine also pushed HDR into the spotlight during E3 in 2004 and set a new standard for realism in video games. Today, HDR is not just popular, it's practically a standard in modern AAA games and engines. So, let's take a look, shall we? HDR and tone mapping are basically two halves of the same post-processing pipeline. HDR means that instead of rendering directly into an RGBA buffer with an unsigned byte as the data type, we use floating points. This can be the standard 32 bits version of the floating point or 16 bits for half precision. I'll be using the smaller type here because it takes half the memory space, but you can also experiment with the full version and see whether it works better for you. As far as I know, 16 bits is more common in popular game engines. Rendering into an offline floating point frame buffer allows us to capture the full range calculated in the fragment shader. Now that this HDR frame buffer is ready, we need to compress it back into the valid range of 0 to 1 in a way which will hopefully preserve the original spectrum as much as possible. This process is called tone mapping, and the function that maps the source value to the destination value is called a tone mapping operator. In general, there are two types of operators, local and global operators. A local operator needs only the pixel color from the HDR frame buffer and nothing else. A simple and popular example is Reinhard tone mapping, which takes the following form. This function can handle any input range, and as you can see, it is asymptotic to 1. Of course, the lower values get a larger range compared to the higher values, so eventually the result will be 255 nevertheless, but it is still much better than simply using the original color. Here's the Reinhard method in action, and as you can see, the results are quite decent and can serve you well in many cases. The Reinhard method was improved by various algorithms which depend on the dynamic properties of the image. These are the global operators. There are a couple of key concepts here: the average luminance and the exposure. In general, luminance is the measure of the perceived brightness. For a given pixel, we calculate it using a dot product between the pixel and these weird-looking magic values. They come from the Rec. 709 standard, which specifies a scheme for digital encoding of colors. In a nutshell, they mimic how a human eye perceives brightness, where the green channel gets the most influence, followed by the red and finally the blue. We are usually interested in the average luminance of the entire frame, and not just a single pixel. This reflects the overall brightness level of the scene. But instead of simply using the average, most HDR algorithms use the log average luminance, which handles outliers and high contrast better. The second concept, exposure, is the digital equivalent of aperture in photography, which controls the amount of light that goes through the lens of the camera into the sensor. For us here, the exposure is a scaling factor that tells us how the image looks like before tone mapping. The exposure is very easy to calculate. It's the target gray value divided by the log average luminance. The target gray value defines the luminance level that the system considers to be neutral or balanced. In photography as well as graphics, this is not 50% brightness, it's actually around 18%, which explains this formula. You may want to tune the target gray value based on the environment. Given the average luminance and the exposure, this is how we can extend the Reinhard calculation to use them. Sounds easy enough, but there is a problem, of course. The average luminance depends on all the pixels in the image, so how do we calculate it? My first attempt was CPU-based. After rendering the frame into the HDR frame buffer, I used GIL getTextImage to get all the pixels into a CPU buffer. Then I ran over the entire buffer, calculated the luminance as a dot product between the pixel and the magic trio, and summed up the result of the log function on the luminance plus some epsilon value. Finally, I divided the total sum by the number of pixels to get the average. I ran this code and the frame rate dropped to something like 30 FPS. What do you think was the culprit? GIL getTextImage or the for loop? If you said the former, then you are correct. Getting the entire frame buffer from the GPU to the CPU was simply too much for my system, and I'm guessing the result on other systems will be similar. Therefore, I went ahead and implemented the same algorithm on the GPU using the compute shader. Let's take a look at the pipeline at this point. The lighting shader writes into a floating point frame buffer, which is processed by the HDR compute shader. The output of the compute shader is a luminance buffer from which we can easily calculate the exposure. The floating point frame buffer is also fed into a tone mapping shader, which takes the exposure as a uniform parameter. The tone mapping shader is in fact a fragment shader, which writes into the default frame buffer. Now let's see how the compute shader works. The HDR frame buffer is divided into tiles, and each tile is processed by a single word group. This frame buffer is bound for reading in the compute shader. Each thread in the word group uses its global invocation ID in order to sample from the HDR frame buffer. The global invocation ID represents the X and Y location of the current pixel inside the entire image. The thread calculates the same dot product between the pixel and the magic trio, then the log function, and writes the result into a buffer which is shared with the other threads in the same word group. It uses its local invocation ID as an index, so the threads don't overlap each other. The thread goes into a barrier which allows it to continue only after all the other threads have completed their own work. Then, only the first thread in each word group sums up the results of all the other threads and writes the final sum into a buffer which contains one result per word group. The thread uses the X and Y of the word group ID and the number of word groups along the X to calculate the index into this buffer. What should be the local size of the word group? For best performance, I assume that it will be something like 16, 32, or even 64. It actually depends on the underlying hardware. Remember that the local size is the number of pixels in each tile. I decided to go with a tile of 10x10 because the image is HD or 1920x1080, and I wanted something which will divide the image size without remainder. This makes it easier for me to compare the results with the CPU version without handling all sorts of corner cases. Therefore, the number of word groups along the X is 192, and the size of the local array is 100. On the application side, we have to allocate a buffer for the results of all the word groups. So we divide the window width and height by the local size on the X and Y, respectively, to get the number of word groups. The number of tiles is the product of these two values, and the total size of the buffer in bytes is the number of tiles times the size of the floating point. The final reduction of this buffer is done on the CPU, so we make sure to set the map read and client storage bits when allocating the buffer to enable read access. Here's how we launch the compute shader. The HDR buffer is bound for reading, and the Luminance SSBO with the results of the compute shader is bound to binding point 1. We enable the compute shader and call dispatch for the number of workgroups on the X and Y. Z is of course 1 in this case. We wait for the compute shader to complete using a memory barrier. Since we're using an SSBO for the output instead of a texture, we can use GL map named buffer range to map the buffer. Remember that in the compute shader we summed up the results of the log function for each tile, so now we just need to sum up the tiles. The size of the luminance buffer is 1% the size of the HDR frame buffer, so we can do this process while maintaining 60 FPS. The average log luminance and the exposure are calculated in the same way. Here's what we need to change in our tone mapping shader. We scale the color from the HDR frame buffer by the exposure and use that in the Reinhard operator. Another option which you may want to explore is to clamp the average luminance inside some range for better stability. Also notice that I've included the option to enable and disable gamma correction, which you will often find together with HDR and tone mapping. But this is a topic for a future video. So thank you for watching, and I will see you next time.